Welcome everyone to the MIT Social Entrepreneurship Alumni Group Zoom event, Building Communities for Impact and Diversity in Tech, featuring Elpha. I'm Lily Fierro, VP of Engagement for MIT SEAG, and I'll be moderating today's conversation with Sayuri Sharper, our founder and president. And I'm super pleased to have as our guest today the founder and CEO of Elpha, Cadran Cowansage. Cadran has had a fascinating career journey that has taken her from engineering at vibrant startups and Y Combinator to community building with the creation and continued growth of Elpha, which is a community for women in tech. And I'm also excited to have her here because for me, during the pandemic, when finding community was becoming more challenging, I personally became a member of Elpha, and I've always been impressed by the knowledge and the generosity of the members and the diverse and incredibly thoughtful initiatives from Cadran and her team. And today's event is an interactive conversation with Cadran. I'll begin with a set of questions, and then we'll take questions from the audience. And when it actually comes time for questions, we're going to do things a little bit differently from other SEAG webinars. This time, when you have a question, we'll unmute you, and you are welcome to go ahead and ask the question directly to Cadran. And before
let me just add that you can use the raise hand with the Zoom to indicate that you have a question and you want to ask it. So there's no need to put it into Q&A before you raise your hand and ask your question.
Absolutely.
Go ahead, Lily. Sorry for the interruption.
Oh, no problem. It's a little bit of a different setup than our usual. And so then I'd like to say a few words about our alumni group. We are organized under the MIT Alumni Association, and our mission is to bring together MIT alumni and like-minded people to co-create a better world through social entrepreneurship and impact investing. And terminology here is important. What do we mean by social entrepreneurship? And here we mean any organization that is addressing unmet social needs or environmental problems through a market-driven approach. And impact investments are investments made with the intent to contribute measurable, positive social or environmental impact. And if any of you are not a SEAG member yet, I'd like to invite you to join us on our online community where we share resources and host member live pitch sessions, mentoring programs, networking events to connect our members and webinars just like this one. And to join, please go to mit-seag.mn.co. And with that being said, let's go ahead and dive in and give a warm welcome to Cadran. And very excited to have you here. And just to get started, could you tell us a little bit more about your journey from engineering to community building?
Of course. So it's great to be here. Thanks for having me. So I would say it was or is pretty fluid, doing a bit of both essentially. So before I started Elpha, I worked on the engineering team at Y Combinator. And Elpha actually started as a side project while I was working at YC. And so I would say my nights and weekends were community management and also, of course, during the day, because communities never sleep. And I was also doing engineering work. The other thing, of course, is that I built most of the software for Elpha. And so I was, you know, constantly building in addition to managing the community. So learning how to manage a community is something that I learned by doing very much. I had no prior experience with online community management, but I had a lot of opinions about it. And so it was really learning as the community scaled and understanding what they needed and how to best structure the space.
And why do you feel that Elpha is incredibly important and communities like Elpha are important for creating a more equitable and diverse tech workforce? An industry, as you know, is can sometimes be challenging.
Yeah, for sure. I think it's important for people to have a place to meet people who they relate to, who look like them, who are having the same life experiences or similar life experiences that they might not have access to in their day-to-day at work. One of the reasons I built Elpha was because I found myself very often the only woman on engineering teams. And there were times when something was going on at work and I really was in search of that other woman to talk to who might have a similar experience, you know, be able to relate to it or offer advice. And it was often very hard to find that person. And so really creating a space where women who are having similar experiences have the same backgrounds can come and really share that knowledge and offer advice and support. One of our big goals is to, you know, make sure that women aren't leaving tech, right? So our membership tends to skew sort of mid to senior career. And so making sure that they have the support that they need in order to feel like they want to stay, essentially.
Absolutely. And it's one of the things that I've really found impressive about Elpha is that focus on the mid and to senior career, but also a place where mid to senior level career people are very welcoming towards women who are interested in transitioning into tech. And that kind of safe space is incredibly impressive. And I think that it's something that a lot of people are seeking, but for people actually building communities, it can sometimes be elusive and hard to figure out and hard to gain traction on. What do you feel were the hardest lessons learned in the early community building process for Elpha?
Totally. Good question. I think there are a few things. I think one is, you know, the hardest thing, of course, I think is getting people to interact in your community. And so I think one of the things we learned really fast is that the sort of core to that is making sure that the people who are your early users all have a really specific shared purpose and reason for being there, that it's very clear that they understand what exactly you want them to talk about, and they all have a shared experience or a shared problem that and they want to talk about it. So when we first launched Elpha, we actually were like, this is a space for women to talk. And everyone was like, okay, but what do you want us to talk about? And so, you know, shifting it to really focus specifically on the tech industry and startups and career was really important for us. I think the other piece is just realizing that you as a moderator or a creator have to be really a really big contributor and really engaged in the space. You have to really stoke the community. It's sort of like you have to force it to take off. Like you have to be posting and asking questions and sort of poking at your early users to do the same. So it's definitely something that takes quite a bit of engagement on your part. And I think one of the things that was challenging for me is I think of myself as mostly an internet lurker. And so here I am, an internet lurker trying to, you know, build a community. So I had to sort of learn how to put myself out there and be open. I think, you know, that actually ties into another point, which is that the way you interact with the community, you're really modeling the behavior that you want. And so it's important to sort of represent the values and the behavior that you want other people to do as well within the space. And so for us, like openness, authenticity, directness, providing really practical advice, those are all things that are really important. And so that meant that I had to do those things, which, you know, I think at first was hard for me, but it's like a building a muscle. I got used to just putting it all out there. So
absolutely. And it's one thing that plenty of the community moderators and the key parts of the community do a good job of. And I think all of the initiatives are very consistent in what you're talking about in terms of being model representations of the value of Elpha and also the values that community members, that you hope for from community members too.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think one thing that is interesting that you had mentioned before is that you actually built out the tech for Elpha. And I'm curious about, given the fact that Elpha is an online community, how did you think about the role that technology is going to play in your interactions, especially since you're working off of a pretty much a bespoke solution? Nobody else is using your tech.
Yeah. One of the things that was my opinionated take on community was that the communities that are out there already, the software has all largely been built by men and product decisions made by men. And I was really curious about having our software built by women and how it would be different. And, you know, the belief that it would be different, that we would sort of build in mechanics that were specific to our audience. And so that was very important to me. I'm an engineer, so that also factors in, of course. But just felt like the software that we were hosting Elpha on was sort of integral in making the community a success. And then the other part is, like, you know, I had a specific idea of the sort of features that I thought were really important at the beginning. And anyone who's built a community and has looked around knows that if you have a very specific opinion about what the features should be that you want, it's often very difficult to find those exact things in existing products. So, you know, the engineer in me was like, all right, let's just build it.
And that makes sense. And I love the independent spirit of that decision. And it still leaves this kind of consistent challenge that a lot of community builders face, though, in that whatever your kind of main community technology and platform is not always inherently integrated into most other people's, like, communication platforms, their social media platforms, or whatever tools and methods that they prefer to use in order to communicate with other people. So how do you navigate that challenge and how do you approach it?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, it's definitely difficult. Like, the challenge of making something people value enough that they'll use something new, that they will participate in a new community space, is definitely a big hurdle. And it's something that we've been figuring out as we go. I think, you know, the tricks, or I don't know if they're tricks, but things to think about are, like, how can you bring people back to the app on a routine basis? What are habits you can create that that happen, you know, one or more times a week that they can, you know, come back to the app for, so that they're building those habits, making sure that the app, you know, works well, that kind of good stuff is really important. But of course, you know, when you're creating a new space, and if you do it from scratch and you're competing with, not competing, but, you know, if you're comparing it to, like, a community on Slack, for example, like, Slack is a very robust tool. So inherently at the beginning, you're going to have fewer features. So you need to be offering something different than that, right? You're saying, hey, you have fewer bells and whistles here, but the content and the people are really awesome. And every time you come back here, you're going to have, you know, fresh content that's really interesting for you, or you're going to meet somebody new that you really value. And so there has to be that that reason for getting people back.
Oh, that makes a ton of sense. I think one of the things that I find interesting is that definitely the ability of Elpha to be able to bring people back. Like, I personally am an email person, and the email digests are perfect for me. But I also find it interesting that sometimes there are other different types of event tools that you use in order to kind of foster more basically spontaneous interactions, right? And also just one-on-one interactions. How do you kind of balance that online, more content focus versus the like actual conversation, web-based, video-based, phone-based focus, and juggling between the two?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think, you know, at our core, we're very Reddit. Our feed is very Reddit-like with long-form content. And it's, you know, super important for us at our core that our members are having these really open conversations that are very special to Elpha that you can't get elsewhere. So that is, like, table stakes. Make sure that keeps happening. But, you know, when we survey members and talk to members, a lot of them really also want to meet each other one-on-one. And that piece, you know, happens live. That is a piece that's really important to keeping them engaged with the community as well. And so I think it's really, like, just making sure that you are providing the value to your members that they're really after, and finding the right balance for your community. We also do a live welcome chat every month, and we use a different tool for that. So, and we started that basically from listening to our members that when they're new, they'd really like to have that sort of live initial contact with the team and with other members and have an opportunity to ask questions. So I think talking to the folks that are in the community to understand where the gaps are and where they need a little extra support or where they'd like something a little bit extra and different is really important. And we're always experimenting and iterating with that piece of the community. So while the long form content is like table stakes, it will always be there. The other pieces of like live community building and different sort of ways of matchmaking our members, that's sort of constantly evolving.
Yeah, and that makes sense. In terms of the long form content side of the equation and kind of feature set, how do you approach content moderation, which is a kind of sticky point for a lot of communities?
Yeah, so we do it a little bit differently than many spaces in that we have a mod team, so essentially a community team, and they are active on Elpha all the time. So they are basically live modding. And then we also have buttons in the app where you can flag content, flag comments. When somebody flags something, it's immediately removed. So it's sort of like, we believe you that there's something wrong with this, and then we review it. And if it isn't a problem, we'll reinstate the content. So we take the remove it first, validate what you're saying is a violation, and go from there as well. So it's a little bit different in a few different ways. And that's really important, I think, for helping people feel really comfortable and confident. We actually don't have a ton of issues with people doing crazy things. I think part of that is because we have a bit of a review process for members who can post on Elpha. So you just apply to be a member, but you're applying with your real identity. And I think the other piece is just sort of the way that we've shown people how we want them to interact with each other on Elpha. And I would say the community is really awesome at sort of modeling that and like being really kind to each other. So we do occasionally have issues, but it's not super crazy.
Yeah, no, and I feel like that's one of the kind of core values as a member of Elpha that I get when I'm there. And in general, given that women in tech do come, even if they're from early, mid, or later stages in their career, they come from kind of all walks of life and have different expectations possibly from the community itself. How do you kind of nail down the values and of each community member and then try your best to ensure that the long-form content or the live community building events meet the values of the community members?
Yeah, so that's very hard, right? The way we thought about it is we have a few archetypes for different types of members. Obviously, not everybody fits into one of those buckets, but from talking to users and surveying members, we sort of learned that there are some specific archetypes, and each one has their own sort of set of like problems and things they're really focused on. And so we try to sort of build around those and think about, sometimes we'll focus on one with a piece of content. Sometimes we'll try to provide value to a few different archetypes in the same piece of content, because there is of course overlap. But that's really our focus. Is I think it's difficult to try and please everybody at once. And so we will often focus on one for any particular initiative or content, and try not to only focus on one, sort of give everybody their moment. So, but I think the other thing is, in general, people, one thing that's shared with members who are there is that they do want to meet other members, right? There are common qualities among members. And so if there are common qualities, those are ones that are great to lean on, because when you do have the opportunity to sort of satisfy everybody, that is wanted to take advantage of. So if everybody wants to get to know each other better, that's, you know, a real opportunity to build something for them. And that's one of the reasons why we do our one-on-one and in group chats, is because that's sort of a common theme among different types of members.
Absolutely. And that makes a ton of sense. You know, one thing in the community building space that is always interesting is you've mentioned surveys, but are there other ways that you measure the success of your initiatives and your experiments?
Yeah, I mean, we look at active usage. So daily active, weekly active, monthly active usage, and then retention is a big one also. See, making sure that members who sign up actually return and how that changes over time. We do surveys, we use NPS scores in our surveys. And then, you know, we also do use anecdotal information from members. So we're constantly talking to them and, you know, learning about their wants and needs and any feedback they have. And very often that anecdotal feedback will start to hear, you know, more than once, and it's clear that there's something to work on there. So, so it's not always a volume game.
No, and that's great to hear, is I think that a lot of times you'll see community related guidance that is focused on kind of a translation of like stickiness, and that's not what it's all about, right? You can't boil down building relationships into stickiness of content.
Yeah, I agree with that. And it's an interesting balance, because like the content stickiness is such an important part of getting people to come back. But of course, like different people have, I think especially with like professional spaces, they have sort of different expectations of how long they want to, or how often they want to come back. And then also people go through phases, like if you're job searching versus if you just started a new job, and that very much has to do with professional engagement. So understanding those sort of cycles about your users and how to keep them and retain them even when they're sort of in transition is really important.
Absolutely. And with that being said, given that Elpha is primarily online, what do you feel is the future of online communities? I think that the pandemic has shown us that they are incredibly valuable, but where do you see it growing? Where do you see kind of spots that you would like to work on and Elpha is actively working on?
Yeah, so I think it's really exciting to see how many more people have gotten comfortable with online communities, and also the idea of meeting somebody new and building a relationship with somebody that maybe you haven't met in person. I think a lot of people who hadn't ever done that before did it during the pandemic. I think that people leaving cities and working remote, moving to other places, is something that is going to stick around. And because that's going to stick around, people are going to need to continue to access online spaces in order to have connections when they maybe don't have a tech hub where they live, or there isn't a professional community wherever they're located. And so I do think that a lot of the behaviors that we've seen during the pandemic are going to stick around. And I think that's very exciting. In terms of where we're headed, you know, I think we'll always be really focused on building community. One piece of that that we have been, you know, hard at work at is the career and job side of things. So helping our members find new job opportunities. And that is actually, we talk about it also, but that's our revenue model as well. And so that's something where when we help a member find an awesome job, they're like extremely excited and it's very rewarding. And I think it's also really, really important and useful to make sure that that our members are aware of, opportunities like being the first at a really interesting new startup, or, you know, an unlisted role at a bigger tech company, like making sure our members have access to those opportunities. So that's something that we're really focused on right now.
Awesome. And do you ever foresee a point where you would ever need to go into some sort of hybrid model where you do have like a very active online presence, but there's also a complementary in-person component as well?
Yeah, you know, we do occasionally do in-person events. We actually did one recently in New York. often those are spearheaded by members. Also, like a member will host a meetup in a particular city. And I think that's fantastic. Like if people are excited and want to meet in person, like more power to them. We do host those ourselves also at times. And it's something that's a little more ad hoc too, but I do think for sure that there's value in people having the opportunity to meet in person. The piece that, you know, we just are thoughtful about is the fact that not everybody lives in the same place. So making sure that we're not leaving out swaths of people. We're sort of thinking about all of the different geographies when we're planning. So, but yeah.
Yeah, no, that makes a ton of sense because you're also an international community, correct?
Yeah, we have an international audience. It's about 25% based outside the US. So it is US focused, but very, very international as well. So yes, being thoughtful about time zones when we schedule events, being thoughtful about, you know, if it is in person, are we doing events that are also remote to support those other members as well? So definitely thinking about that for sure.
Yeah, time zones are a challenge. And it's definitely something that we see here with MIT SEAG, because we're an international community too. And it's not always the easiest, but yeah, trying to be mindful of it as much as you can is a big part of thinking about any live or just really scheduled event.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, I have time zones.
I think with that being said, those are all of my questions. I'd like to turn it over to Sayuri to see if she has any questions.
Yeah, Cadran, thank you so much for this opportunity for us to learn from you. We have about 500 members at this point, but it's been difficult to create opportunity for members to interact with each other. I wanted to understand a little bit of your experience. Was there kind of a threshold, at a certain point that people started interacting? How did you get that started?
Yeah, it's definitely different in different sizes. In the early days, when you're under maybe 1,000 users, you have to work. I'll just speak from my experience. We had to really stoke the community, really, you know, actively participate and get people talking and lead conversations and, you know, sort of nudge people to lead their own conversations. So there is that like grind piece of online community where in the early days, you have to sort of get it kickstarted yourself. So that's what we saw. You know, as the community grows, I don't remember the exact number, but, you know, it's at some number of thousands, all of a sudden it was like, oh, when I come to Elpha, there are all these interesting conversations and I don't need to post anything unless I want to post something at this moment. I had that realization and that was very exciting. And so, you know, you definitely get to that point, but it does take time and it takes effort, you know, to like really, and really thinking through like, what are the topics that are really interesting to our members, putting together like a list of questions to ask the community, keeping up on news so that you can share news with them. Like, I think it's really a question of what appeals to your community and what you want them to talk about. And then, you know, really doing a brainstorm about like how you can see that.
So how many of you were there at that early stage to post and encourage interaction?
Yeah, so I mean, it was just me working on this as a side project, but I also was working at Y Combinator and my coworkers were really amazing. And so all the women who were working at YC were my first users and they were just like super supportive and kind about helping me get this off the ground. And so, you know, I would Slack one of them on our like internal channel at work and say, hey, can you post this on Elpha? And they were always game. And they also, you know, without my prompting, were also participating, which was part of the reason why I thought it had legs, is like, as soon as we sort of got people used to posting things on Elpha, they would do it themselves. And so, you know, it was sort of funny because someone would come up to me and be like, Cadran, I have this question for you about X, Y, and Z. And I'd be like, I will only answer you if you ask me that on Elpha, you know, really pushing people to use the platform. So just, you know, normal founder things.
That's great. And then my other question was that you said that there are some important features that were lacking in other platforms. What are those features that you think really helped for you to build this community?
I think having the ability to define our own moderation tools and our, like, the way we do let members flag content is a bit different than how other communities do it. So having the ability to define that ourselves, and then we do an email digest. And so having quite a bit of control over that and the content in it, having control over the onboarding experience for new members, like those kinds of bits where we want a particular experience. And so being able to really dig into that. And then of course, like the data piece, like to really be able to dig into the, you know, the data in all the ways that we want to, without being limited by sort of the container of an existing platform.
Okay, and there's encouraging people to post, and there is getting them to do more one-on-one, more individualized conversation. Was there anything specific you did to encourage that happening? So they become a you know, community within the community.
We did not think about community within the community or one-on-one interactions until we were quite a bit bigger. When you're small, the community feels intimate by nature because there aren't that many people in it. And so, you know, when you're of the size that everybody can reasonably actually know each other, I think just focusing on getting everybody talking in that sort of public space, because public doesn't feel super public, right? It feels like a small group. It feels like hopefully more like a living room in someone's home than a conference hall. I think as you get bigger, when people start to feel like the space doesn't feel intimate anymore and like they don't know all the users anymore, that's the point at which you start to think, okay, how can we sort of recapture that experience so people feel really comfortable. And that's a point at which I would think about smaller groups or connecting members one-on-one and things like that. So I think early days, the thing to focus on is like, how can you get the kind of content that people are really excited about? How can you get the type of conversations happening that people really wanna see that are like really unique to your platform, like really focusing your energy there?
Yeah, you know, people can post things that are not personal, but if there are kind of personal issues that they want to explore, like what you were talking about, were your users comfortable to just post those or?
Yeah, I think it's a mix. So we had some early users who were very open and would talk very openly with their real identities about what was going on in their lives. And so having some members leading by example there was really valuable. The other thing is that on Elpha, one of the sort of unique pieces of our software that we've built is that as a member, you can post like pseudo anonymously. So you can post under one or more handles. You can basically create multiple handles and post under any of those when you post. And so it creates the opportunity for people to talk about something that's, you know, very private or controversial, or maybe they're worried would get them fired at work, you know, things like that. And we do see people really using that feature the way we expect. So we haven't had a ton of, I think the worry with anonymous posting was always for me that people were going to abuse it or say awful things or something like that, but we haven't really had that issue. So
that's great. So I see that we have one question from Juan, and rather than my reading it, Juan, do you want to ask that live, unmute yourself and ask your question directly. Okay, since he has not responded, I am going to read the question. It says, thanks, Cadran, for sharing your battles and enthusiasm. Please share with us more about your start and what you did to motivate and recruit initial members and scaled it up.
Yeah. So I would say for recruiting initial members, I would think about, is there a group of people that all are already familiar with each other or are already, you know, part of somehow the same like some other existing group, like either they all, you know, a group like this, for example, you all went to the same university, you have a similar set of interests and something specific, like that's sort of the kernel that you want in order to create a space so that people feel like you have this sort of shared experience, you have a shared purpose for why you're there, and that there are already some social norms that you share that you're like comfortable with. Ideally, it's a group of people that all know each other in the real world, so they are extra comfortable talking to each other. So I would really focus on figuring out how you can find that type of group and then get them to use your software or, you know, wherever your community is hosted, get them to participate in your community. It doesn't need to be a huge group. The early group for Alpha was about 20 women, and it was my coworkers. So, Alpha started as the place where my 20 coworkers were hanging out. And then once I realized that they were enjoying the space, then we expanded it to the women in the YC alumni network. So that was a few hundred more members. And again, you know, that expanding out, that group of next members was still, they all had the shared Y Combinator experience. They were had all been founders. They were had a set of, you know, problems they were all dealing with in tech that were shared as well. And so, you know, thinking through it like that, and I would say expand slowly, right? I would not expand thinking if I get more users, that's going to mean I'm immediately going to get more conversations. I would say with a small group, get to the place where you feel like people are asking really good questions, people are engaging. And once you get there, then think about expanding. So expanding will not solve your engagement problem, basically.
Yeah, I get that. Karev, you have your hand raised. Do you want to speak? Can we unmute Karev?
Yeah, I can go ahead.
Yeah. Good, can you hear great. Me? Yes.
Thanks from my side as well, Cadran. I believe you already done a great job here in building a community, which is the most difficult work to do, I would say, and especially in today's world when we are saying that we are connected virtually, but we are not connected anywhere. And that was my question, the nutshell of my question is that how do you keep people connected? Because as Sayuri said, that we have 500 members, but these 500 members are not connected. We are just there. And how to make this connection alive?
Mm-hmm. You mean how to keep them coming back to connect, or?
So you mentioned during your answers that you have some parameters where you are looking at how many members are active and how many have not done any activity on the portal. And let's say you have one member who has not done any activity for 1 month or 2 months or 3 months. What do you do with that member?
Yeah, I mean, I think there are lots of different things you can do to try and bring people back. One is to show them content that you think is going to be really interesting to them. So, you know, send them an email or push notification about something that's happening on the platform that based on who they are, you think will appeal to them. So bringing them back that way, product launches, bring people back. If you have an event coming up, like there are a variety of things you can try. You know, I think once somebody has churned, it is difficult to get them back. So coming into it with that expectation, but I would start sort of tinkering with what gets people back and thinking about why did they churn in the first place? Like, what is it that they're not getting, and how can you show them that they can now get that through your platform?
Thanks for the answer.
Anybody else in the attendee that have specific questions? Okay. Again, in your starting this, what and I get the idea that you started it from a community and expanded from there. In your first expansion, was it getting just people within the group to invite people they know? How did you expand from that initial group who are pretty know each other to kind of getting other people into the organization?
Yeah, we did do referral-based expansion. So giving everybody, I don't remember, maybe 1 to 3 invites to invite a friend. That was definitely the first way, you know, having people who join know at least one other person and being able to see sort of folks within their network in the space and already using it is definitely a valuable tool for getting them comfortable and also participating. So that's, I think that's very important. And then we did also think about where the types of member, where the people were, who were the people that we wanted to be members, like where were they already hanging out online and going to those places to let them know about the space. So you know, we did reach out to alumni groups at different universities and things like that as well. But definitely the initial piece was through referral. So having members invite their coworkers and friends.
Okay, I have a question from Juan Ribeiro. So can we have him unmuted so that he can ask his question directly? Juan?
Okay.
Go ahead, Juan.
We got it after many. Yeah. Thanks, Cadran, for your enthusiastic talk, and it's very nice to see your smile and enthusiasm. Which ones have been your most challenging moments with any of your groups of interest that moved your emotions more?
Yeah, you know, I think with online community, you never know the sort of what's going on with your members, and often people are dealing with really difficult things. I think especially during times like the pandemic, and that, you know, people, there were tense emotions, people were sort of running hot. And so as a community leader, there are times when people sort of look to you to help them with those things in a way that is not necessarily within the scope of the space that you're running. And so that's really hard because, you know, for me, I am a sort of perhaps overly empathetic person, and I really want to help everyone, but also recognizing sort of what my personal boundaries are, right? And what are the limitations for how I can really work with members one-on-one and support them. So I think that has, you know, is an ongoing challenge, as, and I think is something that you'll run into if you run a community, is like, what are the limits? How do you articulate your personal boundaries in a way that is still kind and is still productive, and still, you know, hopefully people, you know, feel good and understand those limitations. So that for me is a challenge and is an ongoing one. And it's something that we also talk about in our moderators group, because that's something similarly that will happen with our moderators, where they'll get inbounds as well from folks who are asking for very specific sort of one-on-one help that's outside of the scope of Elpha. So, I would say that's one of those challenges.
Yeah. And we have a question from Harpreet. So you should be unmuted and you can talk, Capri. Ask your question.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So Elpha seems phenomenal. Thanks for being with us today. I'm curious what kinds of activities tend to garner the most engagement and how you thought about them. When I went to the platform, I noticed a lot of office hours that really drew me in right away, just because of the leaders that were there. And there were AMAs, and I imagine just so many others. So I'm just curious about your learnings on finding that kind of product market fit of activities, because you do have a wide range of activities as well. Mm-hmm. So I'd love to hear your thinking about that, your experience, and what you've noticed.
Yes, I think providing structure where every week, every month, a certain thing happens that people can return to is a great way to bring people back. And then it's a question of figuring out what those things are. And for us, doing sort of ongoing asynchronous AMAs with sort of high profile women in tech has been one of those things that our members really value and brings folks back to the platform. So I do think that that's an important part of like thinking through engagement and getting people to come back for sure. We do our icebreakers chat. So having a place where new members can come to ask questions and get to know each other. We do that every month as well. And then we have a welcome thread in the community where members can introduce themselves. So we do a number of things like that. And you know, everything that we do basically starts as an experiment. We do it once or twice, see how people like it. If it's something that people are really engaged with and people seem to get value from, then we'll consider continuing it. So definitely being really open and willing to experiment with different types of things. And also if you discover an experiment didn't work, being comfortable with discontinuing whatever the thing is, I think is important too.
That's great. Wow. It's, so how long has it been since you started this to where you're at now?
That's a good question. I'm not actually sure because it was a side project for quite a while. So it's maybe 4 years that we've been in existence, something like that. I should probably know the answer to that, but I'm not totally sure.
Yeah, well, when it's a side project, sometimes it's really hard to figure out.
What is time?
Yeah, sorry. and mostly this is word of mouth still at this point. You don't try to advertise to try and get more members.
Yeah, we do work on word of mouth, so and referral from our members and things like that. So, so that is primarily the way that we grow.
Yeah, and right now membership is free.
Yep. So membership is totally free. You get everything that I mentioned for free. And the way we make money is through our partnerships with companies that are interested in hiring from our membership. So our basic goal is to provide a ton of value to our members, offer it free, and then as an extra service that's also, you know, a revenue opportunity for us, we help them find jobs.
So have you been successful with that in terms of kind of doing job referral and whatnot?
Yeah, I mean, one of the exciting things is that we are working with a lot of really interesting companies. I think we work with companies who are at the seed stage all the way through publicly traded larger companies. But within that, it's like all different kinds. Some of them I didn't know about before that we started working with them, but they're super exciting. And then we've also seen companies that we started working with at, you know, like the seed and early stage go on to raise a lot of money and be really successful. So I think that part is really fun when we can connect somebody with a really interesting opportunity and then we see them and the company that we connected with them really succeeding. Because, you know, a personal goal of mine is basically have more women be those early employees at really exciting startups who have that those sort of opportunities to have the equity and the sort of leadership opportunities. Yeah. So I love it when we make those placements. That makes me personally really happy.
So do you do the matching for them when you, And so how much of the background of your members you ask for to do the match, and how do you decide how to match?
Yeah, so it's really, so first of all, this is something that we're actively working on. So it's something that I would say is changing every day, but we work with companies hands-on and members hands-on to do that matchmaking. Mm-hmm. And then we also have software where members can explore companies and apply for roles directly. So it's a little bit of a blend of the two. And different companies want to work with us in different ways. And similarly, members want to work with us in different ways. So it's really sort of figuring out what works for different people and companies.
Yeah. Okay. Wow. Yeah. That's great. And then we have another question from Juan. Let's take Juan Diaz's question first, and then we'll go to Juan Rivero after. So Juan Diaz, you go.
Hey, Karen, thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate it. You mentioned earlier about experiments that you run when you're trying new activities to see if they work. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about those. How do you come up with them, but specifically also how do you evaluate their success and when to like tweak it or completely stop or change?
Yeah, so typically, you know, it's a brainstorming process. We'll have like a few hypotheses that we wanna test. Usually trying to think of them from a problem place, like there's a problem, here's our hypotheses about how to solve it. And then, you know, just defining what success looks like is usually related to like engagement metrics. Like, did people engage with this? Did they do the thing we wanted them to do? And you know, I think for each experiment, it's different in terms of what the delta is between current state and, you know, what the metrics are that we consider to be success. So it's a little hard to say like one specific number here, but definitely thinking about that in advance and having that be part of sort of how you define your experiment. And then, you know, just making sure you run your experiment for long enough that you have enough data. So, you know, it could be an A/B test about a landing page. It could be a new product feature. It could be a type of content, like all of these different types of experiments are things that we are all, you know, actively doing. And then, you know, once you've hit the amount of time that you wanted to run your experiment for, looking at your data and saying, did we hit whatever our goal was, you know, there's always the question of like, do we need to tune this experiment? Like, are there things we learned from this first iteration and we should try something else? So if you don't get success, it's not necessarily, okay, this is a failure, throw it away. It might be like, we learned these things and maybe we'll tune the experiment, or maybe based on the things we learned, we'll actually run a different one. And so that's really our process for sort of iterating through it. I think the other thing is that when we do launch something new, we tell our members it's an experiment to set expectations so that they don't assume it's something that will be around for the rest of time. It's like, we're figuring out if this works for you, let us know. If it's not working, then we'll try something else is basically the sort of approach that we always take. So I think that also works really well so that like, expectations with our members are set very clearly.
Great. So we're gonna go to the other one next, and Karav, you are after that. So Juan, go ahead, and then we'll have Karav after.
Okay, Karan. Again, that might be a long question, but and it has two sides. First, do you receive or have you received requests for receiving men in your network? How do you handle that? And on the other side of the question or this coin is, what are the characteristics of the functioning of just feminine traits in your network?
I'm going to have to ask you to clarify the second piece because I'm not totally sure I understand. For the first piece, men do have interest in joining. I think a lot of what we're offering to our members is appealing to a wider audience. The way we deal with that is that we basically ask members if they do, or during the onboarding process, we say, do you identify as a man? And if so, then you get a kind of what we call a supporter account, which basically gives you access to the content that is publicly available. So that's content that our members feel good about sharing with a wider audience. That's something that we actually have started to do in the last maybe 6 months. Before that, it was like, this is a space for folks who identify as women. We're very inclusive with that definition. So femme and non-binary people are also welcome to join. And we really think about it as like, is, you know, if a person wants to join Elpha, we explain what it is and say, does this feel like the right space for you? And if they say yes, then, you know, this is how I identify, this is a space that would feel good to me, then they're welcome to join. So that's really how we think about membership. And I need clarity on your second question because I'm not sure I understand.
Okay, are you hearing me? Yeah. Beyond the gender gap, there are some characteristics or traits from feminine and masculine. Mm-hmm. So what would you say are the more prevailing characteristics of the network, given that there are much more women in it?
Yeah.
I'll add on to that is that, is there a benefit to keep the community just women?
Yeah. You know, I think it's really important for there to be a space where our members can connect with other women without having to worry about explaining their experience to men or sort of having that kind of like, if you post about an experience you're having that is gendered or you feel is gendered, having to explain why it is or that context, like having the opportunity to really talk to people who just understand, you know, have been there, like relate to what you're saying. And you know, there's also that sort of safety and comfort in it where you know you're not going to get, you know, trolled or have to worry about some of the kinds of interactions that you have to worry about on other parts of the internet. So that's really our goal is to provide that space where women feel really comfortable being open, being candid, talking about things they might not feel comfortable talking about with men or, you know, in a space that was a little bit broader.
Thanks. And then last question from Karav. Go ahead.
Thanks once again, Cadran. Actually, some of the questions have been asked already by Yuan and Sayuri, but still I have two, like this is also kind of two questions in one. First question, as you mentioned that you made this platform by yourself, Elpha. It means that the platform and all these kind of application experiments, you have one team, those like kind of working on marketing and kind of competitive analysis, kind of like you are checking also that what other platforms are doing, why your platform or how should be your platform different, something like that, right? So what is your team size? And also follow up on that do you have already like a data analyst or algorithm developers who are working on all these kind of matches and so on?
Yeah, so our team size is 12. So we're a very small team. We don't have a data analyst specifically. So, you know, within that small team, you know, different folks are wearing many different hats and are working on a lot of different things. And so, and that includes me too. So I think about product and engineering and plenty more. We're sort of like a classic startup in that sense.
Thank you so much. I guess we are a minute to the end of our time. This has been fantastic. And thanks, Lily, for connecting Cadran to our community. Do you have a final word, Lily, that you would like to say before we close out the webinar?
Yeah, I'd just like to thank Cadran for her openness and for her community and all of the great insights she shared with us. I think like we have plenty to learn, and pretty much anybody who is interested in creating a community or being a part of one has learned a ton from all of your open knowledge. And your representation of the values that you hope for Elpha. So thank you so much.
Oh, of course. Thank you so much for having me. I've really enjoyed it and just really enjoyed getting to know you. So thank you very much.
Thanks so much. All right. Well, I'm going to say bye-bye to everybody. Thank you.
Thank you to all of our attendees. Take care.